A very good afternoon, everyone. Today we are going to speak on a very important topic, that is recurrent abdominal pain, medical and the surgical management. It is a very common problem that you see in your day-to-day OPD practice. I am Dr. Supra Saxena. I am a consultant pediatric gastroenterologist and hepatologist at Manipal Hospital, Dwarka. And I have with me Dr. Sabrawal sir as well. He is a senior consultant and heading pediatric surgery over here at Manipal Hospital. So I'll be talking about the medical aspect and he'll be discussing about the surgical aspect of the abdominal pain. So it's always a dilemma whenever the abdominal pain children come to your clinic or OPDs, because children are often unique and they are different from adults because they have a weak immune system and they require additional support as compared to adults. So treating a chronic abdominal pain is not only challenging for the pediatrician or the physician itself, but it's very, very challenging for the child who's suffering from the condition and the parents, because they are always worried that there might be some underlying condition that the child may be suffering from. Serious condition and why the pain is not getting better, wherein the pediatricians are always in a fix that you know when to treat it on OPD basis and you know when to order certain diagnostic tests if the pain is not getting better. So today I'm going to throw light or you know share with you how to differentiate between functional abdominal disorders and how what all to look out for if you are suspecting an organic cause, and a generalized approach how to go about a diagnosis and management of chronic abdominal pain. So if we look at the terminology, it's an intermittent or constant pain which could be functional or organic in etiology, and it should be present at least for 2 months. Most criteria define it should be present for a period of 3 months, but it should at least be present for a period of 2 months. Important thing is that it encompasses the recurrent abdominal pain, which is defined by 4 criteria, that there should be more than 3 episodes of abdominal pain, the pain should be sufficiently severe to affect the activities, and the episode should occur at least a period of 3 months without any organic cause. Then comes the functional disorders, in which are the condition in which the patient can have variable combination of symptoms and signs without having any identified organic condition. Usually it is because of the interplay of regulatory factors which are there in the enteric and the central nervous system. So a lot of factors interplay. For example, there may be visceral hyperalgesia, reduced threshold for pain, abnormal pain referral after rectal distension, or there may be impaired gastric relaxation in response to meals. Now if you look at the epidemiology, chronic abdominal pain occurs in up to 10 to 20% of children in the age group of 4 to 6 years. There has been studies done in middle and high school children which have reported 17% of them have reported weekly episodes of abdominal pain. So it is quite a common problem in childhood. In 2015, a meta-analysis was done of 58 studies which show an overall prevalence around the world of functional abdominal pain of up to 13%. Now, how and why this pain occurs? So let's look. There are 2 types of pain receptors which are there. One is in the viscera and one is in the parietal peritoneum. So pain receptors which are there in the abdomen, usually they respond either to the mechanical stimulus or the chemical stimulus. So whenever there is involvement of viscera, the visceral pain is usually induced by the mechanical stimulus in the form of either distension, contraction, traction or compression. Whereas mucosal receptors which are present in the mucosa primarily responds to chemical stimuli. For example, bradykinin, substance P, serotonin, etc. And we all know that the chemical stimuli are released in response to inflammation or ischemia. sometimes what happens, all these different stimuli, whether it's mechanical or chemical, they can act together and they can influence the perception of pain. For example, usually we see that gastric mucosa is insensitive to pain. However, when the gastric mucosa gets damaged or inflamed, then these stimuli may cause together pain in the gastric mucosa as well. Also, the threshold for perceiving the pain for visceral stimuli varies amongst individuals, and that's what results in the chronic pain, which can be triggered by an initial insult. For example, a child with functional abdominal pain, the brain-gut communication is altered by a distortion in visceral sensation. So normal process, for example, like normal peristalsis, may be perceived as painful in some children as compared to others. Also, there is visceral hypersensitivity, which can occur through peripheral sensitization at the point of inflammation. Then there is central sensitization or recruitment of non-involved adjacent neurons. These all mechanisms together may predispose to chronic pain even after the initial stimulus has been resolved. This is just an algorithm how biological, environmental and psychosocial factors affect the perception of pain in an individual. The second one is the referred pain. So sometimes the pain which is originated in the viscera is perceived to originate at the distal side, and that pain is called as referred pain. So usually the referred pain is located in the cutaneous dermatome, same as shared by the spinal cord level as the visceral input. For example, the nociceptive stimuli for gallbladder, they enter the spinal cord at the T5 and T10 level. So usually whenever the gallbladder pain is perceived, this is perceived in the scapula. Similarly, when the overlying parietal peritoneum is involved, then the pain will be referred to the right upper quadrant in case of acute cholecystitis. This is a dermatomal distribution, which we all know that pain from abdominal viscera, which are referred to different sites. So this is very important that we all know that they localize according to their embryological origin. So foregut structures, usually the pain is referred to the upper abdomen, for that is the structures which are originating from mouth till the first proximal half of the duodenum. Then the structures from distal half of the duodenum to the middle of transverse colon, the pain is referred to the periumbilicus and the periumbilical region. And then for the hindgut structures, like the remainder of colon, rectum and the genitourinary organs, the pain is usually present in the lower abdominal region. And radiation of pain may provide the insight into diagnosis. For example, we have already seen for the gallbladder, for pancreatitis, the pain may radiate to the back. During the gallbladder disease, the pain may radiate to the right shoulder or the subscapular region. But this is not a hard and fast rule. It will, it will only depend what type of underlying pathology is there. Now, it's very, very important whenever a child presents to you to take a detailed history and look for the location of the pain to rule out an organic etiology, because then only you can decide about what investigation to order and how the child could be managed. So it's very important to remember that we always look for any underlying organic cause. For example, if it's an asymptomatic disorder, usually there will be a history of early morning pain or the pain awakening the child at night with early satiety, nausea or foul smelling or sour breath or burping. There could be occasional occult blood in stool as well. And usually the typical location of the pain is in the epigastric region. If there is carbohydrate malabsorption, for example, lactose intolerance, it's like a crampy pain with diarrhea, with usually frothy stool, bloating, with lot of bloating and gas-related issue because of the malabsorption of the carbohydrate. And it is aggravated by eating dairy or dairy-containing products. Again, the pain is periumbilical or it could be in the lower abdomen. In celiac disease, so the presentation can be a crampy, non-specific abdominal pain. In celiac cases, child may present with chronic diarrhea, anorexia, distension, But in certain cases, the child may just present with poor weight gain or weight loss, malnutrition. They can also present with constipation and iron deficiency anemia. But mostly the pain is in the epigastric region. In constipation, most of the times you will have a history of periamblical pain, but you will see a lot of time the child consistently gives a history of left-sided abdominal pain. And there will be additional history of incomplete evacuation of stool, infrequent stooling, fecal incontinence, or history of large stool once you have given a suppository or some kind of treatment to the child. Again, in adolescent age group, it is very important to look for dysmenorrhea, history of menstruation, gastroesophageal reflux. This is very, very important because sometimes the respiratory symptoms like chronic cough or wheezing doesn't get better. So it's very important to remember that there could be a underlying reflux which may be causing this wheezing or chronic cough. If in a bigger child, they may have associated epigastric or upper abdominal pain. Then there could be musculoskeletal pain if the child has got hernia or hematoma. So the pain usually occurs with some kind of physical activity. There could be underlying muscle tenderness or positive carnal sign. I would not go into the details. Probably sir will be the best person to differentiate how we differentiate between an abdominal wall and organ pain by using the carnal sign. Then there are pain which is related to infections, but those children have associated diarrhea or exposure history, and they usually present with diffuse abdominal pain. Also important to rule out less common causes of pain like endometriosis in adolescent girls, esophagic esophagitis. This is very, very common with food allergy, rising incidence of food allergy. Kids come with usually upper abdominal pain. They may have a history of vomiting or dysphagia or food infection, or they may not have a history. Similarly for food allergy as well, if it is IgE mediated, then the abdominal pain is immediate in onset, usually within minutes to hours of ingestion of food, and the diarrhea also follows. Whereas if it is non-IgE mediated, then it can present with chronic diarrhea, poor weight gain, or blood or mucus in stool for a long time. Other less common but important organic disorders is very, very important, because a lot of time inflammatory bowel disease, especially Crohn's, may present with just lower abdominal pain, with some kind of gross or awful blood in the stool, with short stature and poor weight gain. They may not have always classic history of diarrhea, weight loss and blood in stool. So it's very important to remember to rule out these disorders as well. Similarly, pelvic inflammatory diseases in adolescent children and UTI, which is again a very common cause of abdominal pain in children. This is again a summary of alarm findings. So what you will get in history is any history of involuntary weight loss probably will point toward malabsorption, difficulty swallowing or painful swallowing, which points towards eosinophilic esophagitis or any kind of esophagitis or eclasia, significant vomiting. So significant vomiting can be associated with aspergillus disease or cyclic vomiting syndrome or eosinophilic gastroenteritis. If it is really severe, then bowel obstruction is another option. Then it is present in hepatobiliary disease and cholecystitis as well. Chronic severe diarrhea, think about enteric infection, food protein induced enteropathy, inflammatory bowel disease. Urinary symptoms, back pain. So child usually presented with acute back pain and abdominal pain. Think of chronic pancreatitis, and accordingly we have to order the investigation. Family history of IBD, celiac or peptic ulcer disease is very, very important, because usually these conditions doesn't, especially IBD or functional bowel disorders, don't have specific treatment. It's very important to diagnose them right first. IBD have variable presentation in the form of bloody diarrhea as well. Then look out for melena, skin changes in different conditions. In examination, most important is to plot their growth. So if there is any decrease in the growth or delayed growth or delayed puberty, it is very, very important. Ulcerations, which is common in IPD, look for localized upper quadrant tenderness in hepatobiliary disease or right lower quadrant tenderness in chronic appendicitis, ovarian cyst. Left lower quadrant pain, as I said earlier, in constipation, it could be a mass or ulcerative colitis. Suprapubic tenderness in UTI, organomegalies, or costovertebral ankle tenderness. So, in all, a very good history and a clinical examination is must in child presenting with recurrent abdominal pain to look out for any organ. Now, there is room for diagnostic criteria which shares with you the functional abdominal pain disorders, because we have looked in the organic disorders. Now, these are the disorders which are functional in nature, and they have been categorized into functional dyspepsia, irritable bowel syndrome, abdominal migraine, then functional abdominal pain which is not otherwise specified, and functional constipation. Each of them is an entity in itself, and they need a long discussion, because we are always confused that, you know, when to label them as functional disorder and how to treat them. So I'm just going to summarize and, you know, give you a rough idea what exactly they are and how we should go about. So usually all the functional disorders, they are ill-defined and poorly localized, or periumbilical episodes of burn, usually last less than an hour. They resolve spontaneously. They may be accompanied by pallor, nausea, or dizziness, or may be triggered or exacerbated during stress. The most important thing is the child is well and functional normally in between the episodes. So there are no alarming signs in such disorders. An important thing, another important thing is there might be family history of positive GI disorders like irritable bowel or reflux or constipation. If you look at the overall prevalence, so this is again very important slide. The most common functional disorders is functional constipation, which has the highest prevalence, around 10% out of all of them, followed by functional dyspepsia, which is 3%. Functional abdominal pain is again 2.4%, and irritable bowel syndrome is 2.3%. So when people ask about abdominal migraine, so it is not a very, very, very common condition. The overall incidence is only 0.5% out of all the functional abdominal disorders. So, I'll just share one or two cases with you to give you a rough idea what exactly is functional dyspepsia. So 14-year boy with 2-month history of bothersome postprandial fullness, early satiety, epigastric pain, epigastric burning, with normal physical examination, normal screening labs, all labs have been normal. Now, should we do a radiological testing in such child? No. Till we don't have an obstructive sign and symptoms, it is not needed. Should we go for an endoscopy? Yes, if there is evidence of vomiting or weight loss, if there is evidence of any positive screening test like the celiac screening or allergic screening, often does not relieve the anxiety. Should we do a pyloric testing? If there is a family history or if the symptoms are really acute, then you should go for a pyloric testing. Now, this is the therapy which has been recommended. Proton pump inhibitors have less than 50% response. There is no increase in response to higher doses. Anti-H. pylori drugs have only 10 to 15% response, and there is no improvement with repeated courses. There is no role of prokinetics or antispasmodics or antidepressants in this disorder, in functional dyspepsia. The second one is irritable bowel syndrome, which presents with abdominal discomfort or pain, usually associated with two or more of the following. It may improve with defecation, it is onset associated with change in stool frequency or stool consistency. There is no evidence of any other disorder, and it should be present for 2 months or more. A lot of studies have been done on various supplements, medications, dietary restrictions in adults. But what have been found to be effective in IBS in children is only one thing. One is psychosocial support, which is most effective, and other thing which I'll come to discuss later, is the peppermint oil, which should be given for almost a period of more than 2 weeks. Then it's abdominal migraine, which consists of paroxysmal episodes of intense acute perineum-like pain that last for more than 1 hour. Intervening periods of normal health, which can last from weeks to months. The pain interferes with normal activities and it should be associated with two or more of the following. So the child will either have anorexia, nausea, vomiting, headache, photophobia or pallor, two or more of them. And there will be a positive history of migraine in the family. This is just a brief treatment of abdominal migraine. Usually it is the non-pharmacological therapy which is recommended initially, which is explanation and reassurance, avoidance of trigger, modification of diet. Then if there is pharmacotherapy and prophylactic therapy. Usually the abortive, which consists of abortive and the prophylactic therapy. Then there is functional abdominal pain syndrome, which is continuous or nearly continuous abdominal pain. It has little or no relationship of pain with eating, defecation or menses. There is some loss of daily functioning. That's why these functional disorders are important. The most important thing is the pain is not feigned. So there is no malingering involved by the child. It will not fit into another functional GI disorders. And usually there should be symptoms for at least 2 months. Duration should be 2 months to 6 months. So how do we go for it? It's very important for the child or the parent to be told to keep a pain diary, to look at the pain time, the duration, the location and severity, the possible triggering factors which could be involved, the remedies or interventions that were tried which made the pain better. For adolescent girls, a menstrual history should be obtained in all adolescent women. Investigations that should be ordered. We all know that there are basic investigations and then the second line investigation. So whatever is the underlying organic etiology that we are suspecting, based on that we should order the basic blood and the second line investigations. Let's go through upper GI endoscopy. Although it has been recommended that it is the second line investigation, and before the introduction of esophagogastroduodenoscopy, the majority of recurrent abdominal pain was categorized as functional. However, after the advent in 1970, organic etiologies gradually became more prominent. And nowadays it has been found that 10%, less than 10% to as much as 50% pain are because of recurrent abdominal pain. So this is, there has been study done by Jen Chupi et al, in which they have done upper endoscopy finding in children with recurrent abdominal pain, in which 150 EGDs were performed in red flag children. So it's very important. We are going to do only endoscopies in which you see evidence of red flag signs in children with recurrent abdominal pain to find out the etiology of their complaints. They found that abnormal findings were present in 84% of patients. The most prevalent were esophagitis, which was in 40%. Regarding the high prevalence of abdominal pain complaints and increasing the application of EGD in diagnosis of etiology findings, precise indication for performing EGD in children with recurrent abdominal pain seems mandatory. So the popular approach is all the children with recurrent abdominal pain who have red flag signs should undergo upper GI endoscopy. So this was the indication for doing the upper GI endoscopy, the kids with raised ESR, with severe anemia, weight loss. So having one or multiple factors, episode of GI bleeding or localized tenderness. And these were the findings, out of which 16% were normal, 20% had hiatal hernia. You see a large chunk had 40% have different grades of esophagitis. So I'm just coming to the end of my presentation. This is just a box guidelines to manage recurrent abdominal pain. Most important thing is explain and reassure, because if you're dealing with functional abdominal pain, this is what is needed. Identification of red flag sign. Avoid psychosocial labeling. Allow normal activity. It is very, very important to encourage normal activity in kids in between when the child is pain-free. Establish regular follow-up. Also make use of judicious second opinion if you think that you are stuck or you're not able to understand, then obviously you should refer to us. Now, there have been various therapies which have been tried, and according to NASPGHAN recommendations, we have seen that only few therapies have been beneficial, out of which a cognitive behavior therapy have been beneficial in recurrent abdominal pain. There was no use of famotidine or adding dietary fiber or lactose-free diet in recurrent abdominal pain. Peppermint oil, as I already said, is likely to be beneficial in irritable bowel syndrome. There has been no result of amitriptyline or lactobacillus DD in irritable bowel syndrome. To summarize, chronic abdominal pain is a common condition in children and adolescents. In most children, it is functional, that is, without any underlying organic disorder. There is evidence that children with functional pain can have symptom clusters. That means they may have features of more than one type of pain. The presence of alarm symptoms or signs such as organic disease and may justify the performance of diagnostic tests by the treating physician. There is inconclusive evidence that a lactose-free diet or a diet rich in fiber may decrease the frequency of pain. There is inconclusive evidence of benefit of acid suppression with H2 receptor antagonists to treat with child with dyspepsia. Although there is evidence that treatment for 2 weeks with peppermint oil may provide benefit in children with IBS, also similarly, cognitive behavior therapy may be useful in improving functional abdominal pain.
Hi, good afternoon. I am Dr. Arvind Sabharwal. I am the pediatric surgeon from Manipal Hospital. Now, whereas a physician has got a long period of time to decide that which therapy is needed, a surgeon sometimes gets into problems because the surgeon doesn't know exactly where the pain is originating. The child is a poor communicator, and it becomes very important for the surgeon to decide whether he should put the knife on the child or not. And normally a surgeon would have a very short time to decide that what should be done. Abdomen was always thought to be a Pandora's box. Over a period of time, however, we have gained a lot of access into it. We've got now various diagnostic modalities through which we can know what is happening in the abdomen. And today we are in no hurry now to go in and operate in each and every patient. Now, abdominal pain in children can be an acute abdomen, which normally comes into the domain of the surgeon. The recurrent pains and the pains which are organic or which are psychogenic and non-traumatic, they normally fall into the realm of a medical treatment, on which Dr. Sufta has already given you a very nice detailed explanation that how we are going to manage these kids with recurrent pains who may have organic causes or psychogenic causes under them. Now, whenever we are talking of abdominal pain in a children, from a surgeon's point of view, my first question would be that whether this pain is traumatic or non-traumatic. The pain in kids can originate anywhere from the GIT, from the hepatobiliary tract, from the genitourinary tract, and also from the musculoskeletal system. But luckily, only less than 5% of all the abdominal pains which would come to us less than 5% will need observation, or even lesser than that will need an exploration. Vast majority of them would have common causes, something like gastroenteritis or worms or constipation or gastritis or the other factors which Dr. Shukla has already so beautifully explained. Now, first is the trauma. Most of the time you will get a history. The child will be able to tell that, well, my friend kicked me in the tummy during the lunch break, or there will be history of fall from cycling, or the child would have fallen for a swing. So normally in majority of cases you will get a history of trauma. And an ultrasound and a CECT abdomen are the two investigations of choice to pinpoint any abdominal injury. At this point, however, I must share my experience with you that there are a lot of kids who come with a muscle pull of the anterior abdominal wall. They will come that there is sudden pain, and the pain typically comes when you ask the child to sit up or to raise his legs, and you will suddenly find that there is pain in the anterior abdominal wall. The points of tenderness normally are just under the rib cage, or they may be on the rectus abdominis muscle. Lot of these kids undergo unnecessary investigations, and whereas they just have a simple muscle pull of the anterior abdominal wall because of sudden movement or pain. In cases wherever we are suspecting a gut injury which is not picked up by a CECT, we might need to do a peritoneal tap to find the presence of bile. Most of the cases of trauma, even a major liver trauma, if we look at this film, you can see a major liver trauma on the liver can be managed non-operatively. They will need an ICU care, but most of them would not require any exploration. Now, when we come to a non-traumatic acute pain, there are two main categories what we are talking about. One is a child who is less than 1 year of age. The first thinking is intussusception. Any child who is more than 2 years of age, severe abdominal pain, the first thinking is appendicitis. The most important thing is that we need to repeatedly observe these children over a period of time, maybe a few minutes, a few hours, to come to a conclusion. Now, even if when we operate, almost 75% of the cases who have a negative exploration in spite of the investigations might have a cause, something like a Meckel's or a small ovarian cyst which has ruptured. And in 25% of the negative explorations, the diagnosis may be made in the post-op period as pyelonephritis or a Hennig-Scherlen purpura. Medical diseases such as inflammatory bowel disease or primary peritonitis also can lead on to some negative explorations. But the central issue will always remain in kids to be appendicitis. So it is very important to take a history in a kid, because it may point you out that what is the probable cause of this pain. Less than 1 year of age, a severe acute pain, the cause may be an intussusception. It may be a malnutrition. It might be a hernia which has been overlooked by the parents. There might be Hirschsprung's. Generally, what we see is that if the sequence comes as that the patient had fever first, followed by vomiting, and then the pain started, the cause most likely is going to be a medical cause. Whereas if the pain is the first symptom and that is followed by vomiting, and then the fever comes, it is more towards a surgical problem. A pain which starts with sudden severe onset may be a pain which is due to a torsion or due to a perforation or due to an intersurrection. Whereas the slower onset pains are the appendicitis pain, which may evolve over a period of time. It may be a pain of pancreatitis or cholecystitis or a urinary tract infection. Most of these pains will take a few hours to gradually increase in intensity. If the patient has got recurrent pain, then as Dr. Shukla has told, inflammatory bowel disease, constipation are the common causes. If the pain is colicky, it is arising from a hollow viscus, maybe from the gut, maybe from the urinary tract. If the vomiting is right at the onset, it may be associated with the colic. So any abdominal colic can give vomiting immediately along with the colic. If the appetite of the child has decreased markedly, then the pain is most likely to arise from the GIT. Whereas if the appetite is normal, the pain is more likely to be from the genitourinary tract. A GI bleed along with the pain could indicate a Meckel's, an HSP or HUS or interception or a volvulus. Past history of any medical problems like nephrotic syndrome or cirrhosis can point out that it might be a primary peritonitis. Whereas any previous surgical history of trauma or previous surgeries could indicate that it might be due to adhesions. In females, it is always important to remember that a follicle cyst rupture or ectopic pregnancy, yes, even ectopic pregnancy, because as we are going through this age, we are likely to see teenage ectopic pregnancies to happen, and they can mislead us. Then it is very important also in the history to see what is the site of the pain and how it radiates. So the working diagnosis by the site of the pain would be that a right upper quadrant pain is either from the liver, cholelithiasis or gallbladder, whereas an epigastric pain is because of GER, gastritis or hepatic ulcer disease. Appendicitis, mesenteric adenitis, Meckel's, ovarian torsion will all give a pain which might start in the mid-abdomen but will gradually shift over onto the right side of the abdomen. Pancreatitis pain will be normally in the mid-abdomen. Obstructions to the small bowel again will give a mid-abdominal pain. Constipation, UTI and ovarian torsion might give the pain in the left quadrant. Now, examination of such a child will show that if the child is restless and writhing in pain, it is more likely to be a colicky pain. And if the child is lying still complaining of pain, it is more likely a peritoneal pain. That means that it is more likely inflammatory pain and the child does not want to move. Tachycardia, tachypnea and a coated tongue again is normally a sign of an inflammatory pathology. In very small kids or maybe infants or younger kids, we might see abdominal wall edema, we might see visible loops, we might see some motion of these loops on the abdominal wall. We also try to elicit tenderness, guarding, rigidity and rebound tenderness. The best way to elicit a rebound tenderness is to gently tap on the child's abdomen rather than pushing deeply and leaving the abdomen. We also listen to bowel sounds. Bowel sounds might be indicating few tinkling sounds. There may be something like a water gushing through. The sounds may be like something water is pushing through. And various bowel sounds will give us an inkling whether it is an IBS or whether it is an obstructive bowel. Again, free air or fluid can be judged on percussion. It's very important to examine the lower chest, auscultate the lower chest to find any evidence of pneumonia in that area. Rectal examination, though not necessary in all the kids, may help. And to also look for a belly rash, because a Henoch Schallen can give rise to an abdominal pain. The investigations normally are hemoglobin, PCB, TLC, DLC. A rapidly falling hemoglobin could indicate that it's a volvulus. A raised total leukocyte count with neutrophilia points to an inflammatory bowel disease. Urine analysis, renal function, liver functions, amylase, of course, will also indicate various diseases of the liver or of the pancreas. One of the important investigations for any abdominal pain may be an X-ray. Now, most of the time, what I have seen is that an X-ray, whenever is ordered as an erect X-ray. Whereas it is mandatory that before you do an erect X-ray, a supine X-ray must also be done. The supine X-ray is a must to find out the level of the bowel obstruction, to look for calcifications, to look for any sentinel loops, to find fixed loop thumbprinting, which is seen normally in cases of any ischemia, the presence of any mass in the abdomen, because the bowel will split around that mass, and to see for the preperitoneal line, which will get obliterated in case of there is any inflammation. The investigation of choice in most of the cases would be an ultrasound of the abdomen, which is non-invasive, easy to do, and does not cause any problem to the child. Followed by an ultrasound, the CECT becomes the most important investigation, whereas both the solid organs, masses, and even cases of intestinal obstruction could be easily diagnosed on a CECT. MRI has got a very limited role in kids for evaluating intestinal pain, or evaluating abdominal pain rather, because number one, it needs a sedation and a GA. It's a long period to do a cholangiogram, and it does not give any additional information to a CECT abdomen. However, MRI may be useful when we are doing a cholangiogram to look for a colloidal cyst, or a urogram to look for anomalies in the urinary system, or it might be helpful if we are suspecting any spinal cause for the abdominal pain. A diagnostic laparoscopy sometimes might be needed in a tubercular abdomen, and a contrast study such as the barium study might be very useful to make a diagnosis of Hirschsprung disease. Now, always beware of a baby who vomits bile. Abdominal pain, the common causes, constipation, a history and an examination might reveal that it's constipation because of an impacted stool which is palpable. An acute appendicitis may be diagnosed by history, examination with a pain and rebound tenderness in the right iliac fossa. Similarly, a torsion might get diagnosed by doing a CBC, by doing an ultrasound, or doing a CT scan. It is very important to always look for an inguinoscrotal mass in a kid with abdominal pain, because we have seen patients with obstructed hernia being missed as an abdominal pain. Henoch Schallen purpura again is common in kids and can give rise to abdominal pain. Mesenteric lymphadenitis, especially after a viral infection, is very common, and an ultrasound will most of the time make a diagnosis. In adolescents, appendicitis followed by diverticulitis, pancreatitis, gallbladder stones, and torsion of intra-abdominal structures are the common causes of acute abdominal pain, and diagnosis again is through all the means that we have already described. So I'll delve a little bit more on appendicitis, because that is a normal or a very common condition in kids which need surgical attention. It's always important that a patient of appendicitis must be seen after 2-3 hours again and reassessed to see what is the intensity of pain. In neonatal period, the diagnosis is almost never done preoperatively, and almost 95% of them will have a perforation by the time they are diagnosed. Even in children, the rate of perforations are quite high, almost 60% described in literature, but the normal perforation rate is somewhere around 30 to 40%, and in 15% of them they will perforate in less than 24 hours. So that is why most of the time we recommend early surgery in patients with appendicitis. We can have leukocytosis with a left shift, PLC more than 15,000, with a neutrophilia more than 80%, a CRP which is raised, and a chest on an X-ray of the abdomen showing a fecalith in the right iliac fossa are almost diagnostic of an acute appendicitis. On an ultrasound, increase of diameter of the appendix more than 7 millimeters in the AP diameter, non-compressible structure, has a sensitivity of about 85%. Normally today we are tending to do more and more CCT abdomens, because the ultrasound lot of times is inconclusive. But if on an ultrasound the diagnosis is clear cut, I don't think that we need to really go in and do a CECT. However, if we are suspecting an appendicular mass, we must do a CECT to look for local collections, any other pathologies which might be related in that area. In children, chronic and recurrent appendicitis is a definite clinical entity. And as I will go to the next slide to tell you the non-operative treatment of appendicitis, we see that in early appendicitis, most of the kids will get okay after getting some antibiotics, but then they will recur. They will come back, a small percentage will come back. And these are the patients who will be diagnosed as recurrent appendicitis. Barium wheel and enema used to be done initially, but I think today it has been replaced by doing a CCT abdomen. The treatment of choice is to do a laparoscopy today. Open surgery is hardly now done in these days, and most of the kids we are able to resolve them with the laparoscopy. But sometimes, if because of local mass or because of problems, we might need to convert these patients into an open surgery. There is a lot of talk today of appendicitis non-operative treatment, but one should remember that the non-operative treatment requires antibiotics for 7 to 10 days. There are various scores which have been set up, such as the pediatric appendicitis score, which is based on vomiting, right iliac fossa pain, tenderness, temperature, and these scores are able to predict whether we should operate these kids or not. But normally, if an appendix is less than 10 millimeters, the leukocytosis is less than 15,000, with a near normal CRP, with no pendolith and no pus on either ultrasound or on a CECT, and with a PAS score of less than 6, these are the patients who can be managed non-operatively. This non-operative treatment in non-complicated appendicitis may be effective in 71 to 94% of cases, but almost 30% of these cases will return back within 6 months with a recurrent episode which may need surgical intervention. At any time, whenever we are doing a non-operative treatment, if the treatment is not giving response within 24 to 48 hours, or if there is any deterioration in the condition, patient should be immediately taken up for surgery. Intussusception is another common condition seen in younger children around 9 months to 1 year of age. They normally have had a recent viral illness. They will have intermittent severe visceral pain where the child is cramping, and the mother and the parents can visibly see the cramps. the rectal examination or even the per-rectal blood will clinch the diagnosis. Eventually, they will develop a distal bowel obstruction and behave like an obstructed bowel. This is the typical red current stool which comes in these kids. Diagnosis is by doing an ultrasound or a palpation of a mass. The treatment is most of the time hydrostatic reduction, and surgical reduction is very infrequently done these days. Most of these kids will go well with a hydrostatic reduction. However, I must point it out that there is a condition where we have an ileal interception. These are the kids which will not need any surgical treatment immediately. Most of them will reduce by themselves. They may become recurrent, but most of them will not require any surgery. Then the children could have interstinal obstruction. The differential diagnosis would be a paralytic ileus, necrotizing enterocolitis or peritonitis. Cause mostly malnutrition, could be bands, which are not very common, could be adhesions due to early surgery, could be an obstructed hernia. Ultrasound, CCT abdomen, these are the various causes for obstruction in kids. Important is to find out a midgut volvulus and treat it as the earliest. Now, surgery becomes essential in cases of appendicitis and obstruction, perforations, gonad pains, and gallbladder disease and methods. It may become essential if there is a primary torsion of the omentum, if there is a perinephric abscess, bladder calculus, if there is a liver abscess, or an ectopic pregnancy. Liver and gallbladder disease are not common. We very frequently see liver abscesses giving rise to severe abdominal pain with fever. Majority of them are staph oriented pyogenic infections, and they may need exploration and drainage. Cholecystitis is becoming more and more common in kids. The guidelines are the same as we have followed for adults, and a cholecystectomy is the routine treatment. Laparoscopic cholecystectomy is the standard for treatment, and we normally use smaller instruments to take out the gallbladder. A urinary tract pain is also very commonly seen in kids, which might be because of pyelonephritis or cystitis. There might be a urinary calculus. The pain is usually in the flanks and the back, and it is suprapubic if the pain is because of cystitis. The pain usually will get referred from the flank towards the groin or towards the back. There might be pain which gets referred to the tip of the penis. And there are tumors like Wilms and neuroblastomas, which also can give rise to abdominal pain, which might be persistent. Then very important to note that gonadal pain can initially present as a very severe mid-abdominal pain. The most important thing is that the time factor is very important. A pain which is arising from testes and coming to the mid-abdomen, maybe because of a torsion, and within 6 to 8 hours, this testes will degenerate. So it is very important to keep that in mind. A follicular cyst, menarche, or an ovarian torsion can also give rise to severe abdominal pain and should be diagnosed early if we have to salvage that ovary. Ultrasound is the most important diagnostic tool. So with that, I think I wrap up the surgical problems, and we are ready to take any questions that might come on the screen.
So there is a question from Dr. Vivek. So first he has asked that which painkiller do you prefer in abdominal functional pain and its duration? And is there a role of lactobacillus reuteri in functional pain? So I'll answer them one by one. Dr. Vivek, usually in functional abdominal pain, there is no role of painkillers unless it's extremely, extremely severe, because most of the kids, when you see this pain comes and goes off, if there is only in certain conditions like in irritable, if we are suspecting an irritable bowel syndrome, or if there is a functional constipation, then we know the definitive treatment. Other than that, we only give them supportive care and behavioral therapy. Probably ask them to keep a pain diary, because in most of these cases, painkillers are not useful or helpful. The second one, yes, is there a role of lactobacillus reuteri in functional pain? Yes, in, yes, there has been recent studies which have been done using lactobacillus reuteri and lactobacillus DG. And those studies have shown that conditions like functional dyspepsia, functional constipation, there has been some role of using lactobacillus DG, but they need to be given for a period of at least 2 weeks, 2 to 3 weeks or more to have their effect. I hope I have answered your questions, both of them. So with this, we end the session. Thank you very much for attending this medical and the surgical aspect of the abdominal pain, which is a common feature or a disease that you are seeing in your OPD practice. I hope it has been useful. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.